Dialysis is a procedure that is a substitute for many of the normal duties of the kidneys. In the United States, there are over 200,000 people who use dialysis on an ongoing basis. To better understand the kidney's function and how dialysis works, we sat down with Dr. Rodolfo Batarse of Desert Regional Medical Center in Palm Springs.
Dialysis is a technique that's used to replace the function of the kidney. Specifically, dialysis is a machine that cleans the blood, so it acts in, to remove toxins from the blood, filters the blood just like the kidney does, also helps control electrolyte abnormalities that accompany the failing kidney, and help control fluid status, so we don't become edematous or too much fluid in our body and we feel puffy or round or swollen. The best machines we have today are machines that will replace about 10% of your normal kidney function. That is the most advanced machines that we have to date in outpatient dialysis. The patient that has kidneys that are failing, that are slowly being hurt, progressively wearing down, and once they reach that level, 10% or less, that's when dialysis can offer help. In certain special populations, people that routinely have very high or abnormal electrolytes like potassium, or people that have problems controlling fluid because they have heart issues, dialysis may, in those special circumstances, be started sooner. Usually what happens is that either they get referred by a primary care physician or from a hospitalization, and the numbers, the metabolic parameters are noted to be abnormal. They get referred to a nephrologist, a kidney doctor, and then the care begins. Sometimes patients don't have access to care, or they themselves don't know they have kidney problems, and they present to the hospital in extremis, meaning an emergency situation, and dialysis gets started right away.
Dr. Batarse discusses the causes of kidney failure.
The most common cause of renal failure and renal insufficiency in the United States is diabetes, by far the most common cause. 55 to 60% of every dialysis patient in the United States is on dialysis or has complete renal failure because of diabetes. Hypertension is a close second, perhaps 25 to 30% depending on which data you evaluate. Diabetes and hypertension together, 70 to 80% of diabetics are hypertensive at the diagnosis of diabetes, account for easily 80% plus of the dialysis patients we have. Most diabetics have to be diabetic or hypertensive for at least 15 to 20 years to see true damage to the kidney that will require dialysis. Younger folks that are on dialysis, say in their teens and 20s, may have congenital anomalies, meaning they're born with kidney disease or they're born with one kidney or anatomically deformed kidneys. Also, they may have had trauma, or also they have autoimmune diseases, diseases where their own body is confused, their own immune system's confused, and attacks the kidney as if it was something bad, like a bacteria or virus. And then their own immune system kind of finishes off their kidneys. And that tends to happen earlier in life. Dialysis as a modality itself has been actually quite successful. And patients can continue to live and provide and hopefully have good quality of life. And I say hopefully because it's not just a machine. It's obviously the whole care of the entire patient and from the entire medical team. The nephrologist, of course, being an integral part of that. But the patient obviously has to contribute and continue to take care of themselves. That means go see their heart doctor to make sure their heart functions correctly, eat the right diet, which is a special diet for people with kidney disease, kidney failure, and on dialysis, and continue to go to dialysis, meaning not miss treatments, not cut their treatments short, and continue to take care of themselves in that way. People on dialysis can, in fact, continue to live a productive life. Many of my patients still work full-time on dialysis, and they can continue to provide for their families. It is a change in their life, but that's something that we help them adjust and move forward accordingly. The proper diet for someone on dialysis consists of low potassium meals. High potassium can and will hurt the heart. Low phosphorus meals, because phosphorus, if it's too high, will hurt the vasculature and the heart, and the filters can't pull off the phosphorus. Diets that are low in fluids, and those are calculated on an individual basis, because if the kidney doesn't work and you can't urinate, you can't get rid of fluid. Dialysis has to pull that fluid off. I think that the biggest difference coming up is to continue to have better and better filters. So perhaps some of these new filters that are coming, that are being researched and that are coming down the line, is the hope that they can also control some of the phosphorus and some of these electrolytes that are so difficult to control today by diet alone. And if we can control all these different electrolytes, potassium, magnesium, phosphorus, calcium, that the kidney controls with more advanced filters, then the patient has more efficient dialysis and they can continue to live a healthier life.